Hello everyone. Hope you all are doing great. I welcome you all to Finance Brief, a weekly podcast session presented to you all by Finance and Investment Cell of Shaheed Bhagat Singh Evening College. I am Raghav Garg, member of Finance and Investment Cell, host for today's podcast session. Today we have Siddhant Gupta, who has many qualifications. He holds the professional certificate of Chartered Accountant, IFRS, and he is ISB Gold Medalist. Welcome, Siddhant. Yeah, please.
Thanks,
to have
Raghav,
you.
And thanks. Yeah, thank you, entire team. I think it's a pleasure to actually see you know, students. I was doing this a couple of years back, and it's always an honor, or rather, I should say, a privilege to be here on a show hosted by young students. So excited to be here.
Moving on to the questions. So my first question would be, if I am an investor, I have to invest in a business, keeping in mind some favorable strategies for myself. So how do you think of investing in a business if it comes to a business model, like what is the criteria of a potential business model to invest in?
Right. So firstly, you know, some of the most simple, like a few things which one should keep in mind. Of course, a lot has been said about what you need to keep in mind to actually invest. And, you know, you see a lot of theories and you see a lot of models around. In my perspective, a comprehensive analysis is what is required. And that comprehensive analysis has to be twofold. On one side, you need to do a thorough industry analysis. On the other side, you need to do a company analysis. Now, ideally, you should do. So on the industry side, for instance, you know, we learned several frameworks over the years. But broadly speaking, we normally look at what's happening in the industry and how well are the companies who are currently in the industry placed in terms of how strong are their suppliers, how strong are their customers, how strong are the company fundamentals, their competitors, and what is the threat of new entrants coming in? Is there any possibility of any other product taking over the product of existing companies? That will give you an overall analysis. So that's essentially the Porter's five forces. I mean, it sounds theoretical, but that's actually a very good way of analyzing an industry. On the other side, you know, if you look at the company, for example, you take any company, take, let's say, Reliance in India, that's run by Mukesh Ambani and several other notable people in the Reliance team. And if you look at them, they come with like decades of experience being in that company. They've grown within that company, right? So they've got an experience of handling different activities within the company. So that will give you an insight into how the company is functioning. That will give you an insight as to what are the fundamentals of that company. And then you link whether that company is fitting well in the industry. And this is for an existing company, to analyze whether an existing company is fitting in industry. If you want to analyze whether a new company is fitting in industry, you look at what would the prospective products be, whether they will be able to capture the market share that they're actually looking at, whether the promoters will be able to take it forward in terms of their background credentials. So all of these things, once you identify all of these aspects, you need to delve deep into each and every aspect. You need to delve deep into the promoters. When you look at analyzing the promoters, you need to see where they were, what they've done in the past. Similarly for the products, the prices, and everything else. All these things have to be looked at in detail. And once you do this, you will get a good fundamental analysis of the entire company. And if a fundamental of the company is good, I think that's a model worth investing in. The company, if it's an existing company, may not be doing well in terms of stock prices, in terms of giving you a lot of profits now. But a company which is fundamentally strong and which fulfills this criteria, I think will definitely give you good profits in the long run.
Thank you, sir. So moving on to our next question. When we talk about trends in the market, what according to you are the trends, or as we can also say, the trigger events that cause a business to find crafty solutions to different business problems?
Right. So in terms of trends, you know, trends is something which emanates more from a mindset. And social pressure is how I would like to put it, right? If I see someone wearing a black jeans and I like it, I'll start wearing it too. Someone sees two people wearing black jeans, they'll start liking it too, right? That's how the trend starts developing, right? And then you say, okay, black jeans are trending right now. That's how essentially a trend develops. Now, looking at it from the point of view of a trigger factor, I believe that these trends are different for different companies. So for instance, let's say with the pandemic setting in, and even a few years before that, there's a growing trend towards casual wear in office, in the new age startups particularly, right? And a lot of new age startups are not focusing on formal wear in office. And now if I just want to give a very cliched typed example, let's say I take a company like Arrow. So this the shift from formal wear to casual wear would perhaps might have a potential impact on the formal segment of Arrow. That's where it might be a signal for them to focus more on Arrow Sport, which is the casual wear wing of Arrow, right? So that's how a company should spot trends. That's how a company can spot trends. And that's how probably how these factors could play a role in terms of the decision making of the company. Another noteworthy example, which probably might answer your technology question, which you were asking me, informally before we started this session, like in terms of how can technology actually impact businesses, and how can the interplay between both play out well in the long run. So on that front, there is a good example of Erica, which is basically a tech enabled application of the Bank of America, and that sends you a drill down of your monthly expenses and very small expenses. Let's say you spent money on Netflix and several other services, right? And Netflix and other services are trending right now. So what I'm trying to say is they're keeping up with the trend by doing this. And you realize that you actually end up spending a lot of money on these platforms, but you don't realize that you spent a lot of money, because 600 every month does not hurt. But when they all add up at the end of the year, they do hurt, right? They might be noteworthy. So that's what they do. So they're keeping up with the trend by being aware of what the consumers are actually adopting in these times, what the consumers are doing right now. So I believe awareness of what's going on is important, and that will help you spot trends across several sectors and for different companies.
So for a beginner like me who wants to keep a prospective eye on the opportunities available in the market, I really want to know about alternative options. You please give us some insights on how to identify all the possible alternative options behind every prospective idea.
Right. So let me take an example. As a young professional, right, want to solve the problem of air pollution, the pollution caused by vehicles on roads. What is the solution? So one possible solution could be, let's say, have biofuels in your cars. Companies like Shell are doing a lot of work in this area. Another example is, for instance, you could have electric vehicles, right? Just a very cliched example. But what I'm saying is there are several options in front of us. Even when we, let's say, go in for the electric vehicle option, you have a lot of options within that. What type of material, what type of vehicle, scooters, cars, what exactly do you want to do? So there are various alternatives around, right? Coming to your question of how do you actually identify alternatives, I think there's no straightforward way to do it. Like, I cannot say, okay, do 1, 2, 3 and you would have identified all alternatives. The world right now is so dynamic that there are a lot of alternatives around, and the list is not exhaustive, right? It just keeps on piling, building day by day. So you could resort to cold searches on the web to get a deeper idea about what's going on, right? Relating to the idea that you are thinking of. So if you're thinking of doing something in the renewable space, search it up, see what's going on, what's the latest trend, what companies are doing. Discuss it with your friends, discuss it with your network, professional network, discuss it with your faculties as well, like schools, education institutions, wherever you study, discuss it with them. Make sure you discuss it with people you trust the idea, because if the idea is really good, then someone else might do it, right? So make sure you have a general discussion around the idea in terms of, gathering more insights about that idea. That'll help you build more and more perspectives about, okay, what could the possible alternatives be? One thing which I believe is also important is, before we kickstart any venture and in terms of developing alternatives, is a strong market research. Like, for example, a very basic level of market research would be running a survey. Another more advanced technique could be something like a conjoint analysis. This probably you might learn later on. But what I'm saying is these type of research studies also give you an insight as to what the consumers are thinking at present and what could be the possible options, right? So these are just ways of exploring alternatives. So in a nutshell, there is no straight way to find out all the alternatives, but there are many ways to keep exploring alternatives, is how I would like to put it.
Thank you very much. So since we are living in a world where technology has been expanding and booming, I am really curious to know about the scope and possibilities of business cooperation with the world of technology. Does the scope increase or decrease? Could you please throw some light upon it?
Right. So at the outset, I believe that technology has two effects on a business. One effect is, of course, in terms of automation, increasing efficiency, expanding your scale, your reach, and trying to reach more and more people with new and new ideas, right? So that's basically the scale effect, I would say. On the other side, of course, it takes away the employment of a lot of people, right? Because if you have machines doing the same task which 100 people were doing earlier, it's essentially machine replacing 100 jobs. And technology is not creating as many jobs as it is taking away, right? So that is one of the basic challenges. Now, the problem is now, again, so coming back to the question is technology really good? Is technology actually going to be useful? In my perspective, it will, and definitely it is the way forward. If you look at a lot of industries, and I was discussing this with a couple of faculties at the Indian School of Business just recently, investment advising, portfolio management, all of these things are bound to be taken over by robots in the years to come. In terms of, if you feed in a lot of technical data into the machine, it will do a good job, right? So industries like that are bound to get automated. But having said that, we still need to explore ways of how to actually ensure that the people who lose jobs still stay relevant, right? In the whole process of automation and technology. And that's where it's important to explore ways of developing skills at the grassroots level, of upskilling people at the grassroots level, and increasing access to education. If that's done, all of this happens together, it's an ideal state to be in. But if this happens, I believe the interplay of technology and business is the future. And especially look at the past year, right? What was it? How were businesses able to operate? It was technology. Let's say, for example, if there was no Zoom, there was no Microsoft Teams. Do you think that work from home in any setup would have been possible? Absolutely not, right? So technology and business, the interplay will definitely span out very well in the long term. And just an example, like this is a very good example, which I was reading about. Is when we, as young professionals, are very conscious about various aspects of life, right? One such thing is climate change. As a young student, I was very, very careful about not littering the roads, and very careful about, trying to pollute the environment around me by small things, just by avoiding plastic and just these small things. So how do you actually formalize these themes into your business, right? And even technology is playing a great role in helping people do this. So for example, Ant Financial company, the financial wing of Alibaba, it started a project wherein it was rewarding people for saving, it was rewarding people for cutting down on carbon emission in the environment, something like a carbon credit. So carbon credit is essentially given to, let's say, a person for instead of taking a vehicle, he or she cycles to work. So you're helping curb that carbon emission of had you been traveling by car. So that's essentially the concept of how carbon credits work, right? Gives you credit for saving carbon emission. So they're doing a good job in that area by actually gamifying this entire system. So let's say if you do something which saves carbon emissions, they give you points. And at the end of the day, if you, let's say, accumulate 300 green points, they will plant a tree for you in return. So that's how they've involved, they've used technology, they've used their main business model and financial, which gives them access to customers, and they are incorporating that theme of climate change as well, right? So that's how beautifully technology is being used right now. And that's essentially, you can even probably call it fintech. So my point is that absolutely, in a nutshell, technology has a very good effect on business. It has negative effects too. We need to work towards converting the negative to positive, and I think we'll be in a good space.
So, sir, how important is it to have built-in protection from competition in a business model?
Right. So, so let's understand one thing, right? So there's this concept of game theory. So the game theory essentially says that, okay, I let's say, for example, Raghav, you are my competitor, right? And I am a
business. Yes, sir.
If I do this, Raghav will do this. Now, if Raghav will do this and I do this, then Raghav will again respond this way. You keep thinking what, how will you respond to my response? And then I model my response accordingly, right? That's how essentially game theory functions in a nutshell. So to what level can you do that? I mean, you cannot plan for an infinite period of time. You cannot like have built-in strategies for each and every competitive response. The world today, as I said earlier as well, and I will repeat it now, is so dynamic that you cannot plan for each and every strategy of a competitor. What you can do is build some basic responses to the initial competitor actions that you probably might fear. Right? For example, let's say you feel that the competitors might lower their product prices in response to your products. So you could probably have that cushion in your pricing that, okay, if the competitor lowers prices, you are also in a position to lower your price. These are some basic checks. Now, beyond this, what can you do so that you are in a position to always face the competitor? Flexibility. Try to keep your business flexible in order to make it, in the sense that it can, you can change it whenever the competitive action mandates you to do that without much of a hassle. So you're making it flexible that it can survive change whenever, let's say, a competitive action forces you to do that, to do that without minimal disruption. So essentially, flexibility, I believe, in my opinion, is the key that will actually help you tailor your business to competitive actions as you go ahead, rather than try to build in protection for each and every competitive action.
Yes, surely. So flexibility is really important.
Absolutely.
Sir,
yeah.
Yes. So lastly, sir, if you would give a piece of advice for aspiring business analysts.
So I myself am an aspiring business analyst right now, right? So in fact, if you know someone who can give good advice, do let me know. I'll also want that advice. But from my limited experience of working and studying all these years, I believe that what we all should do, right, to be maybe to do well or maybe just develop a good perspective is be inquisitive. Keep questioning things around you. Keep questioning ideas around you. Keep questioning models, theories around you. Also keep exploring business models. Like if you're really interested in actually doing well on the analytic front, if you really want to be someone who can spot business opportunities well, then I believe that studying business models helps. Studying two types of business models, ones that are doing well and ones that have failed, because those who have not succeeded will studying those will help you understand why have they not succeeded, while the ones which are doing well, studying those will help you understand why they're doing well. And that will probably give you a perspective of what is working and what is not working. That will also give you a perspective into how can you identify trends for your businesses. That will also give you a perspective into how can you build protection for your competitors, right? So all the questions that you ask me, if you have an inquisitive mind and if you keep reading and you stay aware about things around you, I believe you'll find the answers on your own. So essentially, it's not really an advice per se, but more like I can put it as my realization that this might help all of us going ahead.
That's a great piece of advice. Thank you, sir, for answering all questions and for this golden nugget. Thank you so much, sir.
Sure. My pleasure. And I think we all in the same boat right now, all moving towards a world where there are a lot of opportunities, a lot of things to explore. So I'm sure we'll all make it through and keep learning on the way. So all the way. So all the best to you guys as well. And again, once again, it was a pleasure being here. I think it's quite nice that I'm doing this. It's quite inspiring.
It's a pleasure to have you with us.